Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of the Pastor's Midweek Bible Study. My name is Hubert Cunningham, and I'm the host for this study. It's always a delight for me to welcome you into this study as we look at God's Word together. I'm also the pastor here at Pennington United Methodist Church. We have been using this format to bring to you a Bible study each week because last year we were forced to worship virtually on YouTube and Facebook and things like that because of the pandemic. And when we were forced out of the worship service in person and forced to worship virtually, one of the things that we lost in addition to worship was we lost Sunday school. So I try to do these lessons each week to help us enrich our study of God's Word, to help us be better disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ and draw closer to Him. And during this time, I've been looking at what I call the Great 50 Days. Now, the Great 50 Days is the period of time between the resurrection of Jesus, which happened on Easter Sunday, and the Pentecost experience, the birthday of the church. From studying God's Word, we know that Jesus appeared on earth for some 40 days past His resurrection. You remember first, He appeared to the women at the tomb. When they came to the tomb to dress the body and anoint the body as they would do normally, they found that the stone had been rolled away, and someone that they presumed to be the gardener, who was really Jesus, said, "He is not here. He is risen, just as He said. Go back and tell the disciples." Then Jesus manifested Himself to the disciples. They were behind locked doors, and He came to them and showed them His hands and His side, and they believed that the resurrection had taken place. When Thomas, who was absent at the time, came back, they said, "Thomas, you should have been here. Jesus was just here, and we have seen the Lord. The resurrection is true." Now Thomas would not believe, and he questioned that and said, "Unless I see for myself, I will not believe." Jesus made somewhat of a cameo appearance back to Thomas and showed him His nail-pierced hands and His side, and Thomas believed. On the road to Emmaus, which is about 7 miles outside of Jerusalem, these two men were on the way home. They were talking about the resurrection, the events that had taken place in Jerusalem just a few days earlier. There was Jesus who caught up with them and entered into a conversation with them. They did not know who He was. He shared a meal with them, and the Scripture says, in the breaking of the bread, Jesus was made known to them. We know that Jesus came again to the disciples and manifested Himself there, and He ate some fish, and there were other times that Jesus appeared to people, some 500 people during these 40 days. This 40-day appearance of Jesus after the resurrection ended when Jesus went to the Mount of Olives and He ascended into heaven. And before He ascended into heaven, He told the disciples to go into Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. And they did for some 10 days. They prayed without ceasing, 10 days and 10 nights. And then Acts chapter 2 tells us on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came and dwelt among them. It filled each of them with the power of God, and it set upon them like cloven tongues, and it was the sound of a mighty rushing wind as it came into that place. Well, the 40 days that Jesus was on earth, plus the 10 days that they spent in prayer, makes the great 50 days. These are very important and interesting times biblically for Christians because we are between the resurrection of Jesus that we celebrated on April the 4th and Pentecost, which is the birthday of the church that we will celebrate on May 23rd. In our Bible studies, we have wanted to focus on what Jesus did following the resurrection. We know that he was on earth 40 days, appeared to over 500 people and so forth. And a lot of things happened during that 40 days that is important to us. But we have to ask the question, why did Jesus appear on earth following the resurrection? Why did he do that? Why did he not just ascend into heaven from the tomb? Well, Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, perhaps gives us a clue as to why Jesus came and appeared 40 days post-resurrection. Acts 1, chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3 says, "The former account I made, O Theophilus," this is Luke writing the book of Acts, "of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he had presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days." Well, that key phrase there, infallible proofs, is important. He wanted them to be witnesses of the resurrection. He wanted them to know that it was not some fictitious event that was something made up. He wanted them to know that the bodily resurrection of Jesus was real. I remember that following September the 11th, 2001, when New York was invaded by terrorists and the World Trade Twin Towers were devastated. There was an attack on the Pentagon. There was an attack in Pennsylvania. And all of that, we were bombarded with that on television. I wanted to make sure that my children understood that that was not just some foreign thing, that that was not just something on TV, that it was real. So we went to New York following the 9/11 experience. A few months later, they were still digging the bodies out of the World Trade Center. They were still identifying some of those people. There was still a lot of debris and so forth in the city. But we went there and looked at that so that my children would understand that that was real. That was something that really happened. And I wanted to impress upon them so that they would never forget the devastation that our country experienced on that day. Jesus wanted his disciples to know that the resurrection was real, that the bodily resurrection took place, and that he was who he said he was, and that things happened just according to the scriptures. Now, he did this because he wanted them to be witnesses of the resurrection. We need to put ourselves in the shoes of these apostles and understand that they were what they were experiencing and how they process this post-resurrection experience. There are really three ways that they experienced this post-resurrection experience. The first thing is they were in a state of shock, unbelief, and fear. Their whole world had changed. You remember how Peter and James were in a discussion right before Jesus shared the Passover meal with them about who would be the greatest in the kingdom of God. And one of them approached Jesus and said, "Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, I would like to be able to sit at your right hand." And another one approached him and said, "Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, I want to sit at your left hand." What they were saying is, "I want a position of authority and power when you come into your kingdom, because I know that that you are destined for something great, and I want to be in on it at the ground floor." Jesus looked at them and mused himself and thought about what they were really asking for. They were really asking for places on the right and left when he was crucified on the cross. They were thinking of positions of power and influence, of greatness, but Jesus was going to suffer and die. And so now, all of a sudden, it had come to reality. And their whole world had changed and changed abruptly. Mark 16 says that they were mourning and weeping days after the event. They were troubled and confused. They were in fear for their very lives. Everything happened seemingly so fast. They did not know what to believe or how to act. So following the resurrection, the body was empty. The crucifixion had just recently taken place. So they went to that same upper room where they shared the Last Supper, and they went behind locked doors thinking, well, if the Roman authorities realized that we were with Jesus, that we were part of his group, his disciples, then we may end up being crucified as well. So we want to protect ourselves as much as possible, the human aspect of it. And who of us would have not wanted to have done the same thing? We would have wanted to get away from the focus of the day and kind of went in hiding for a little while. But the Christian faith is kind of like that too. We expect one thing from Christ if we make our peace with Him and we decide to become a Christian. But sometimes after we do that, we are disappointed because we accept Christ and everything is, we want everything to be perfect in our world from that point on. We want our health restored if we're sick. We want our bills to be paid. We want our relationships to be perfect, and so on. How many people have said, Lord, if you'll, you know, heal me of my cancer, if you'll heal me of my infirmity, I'll serve you the rest of my life. If you'll get me out of prison, get me out of this mess, get me out of this mistake that I've made, I'll serve you for the rest of my life. If you'll just save my marriage, I'll serve you for the rest of my life. Well, you get the idea. What we find, though, is after we accept Christ, life is still life, and life is hard. There are lots of problems, lots of valleys and mountains that we have to transgress, and it is difficult. When we are patient, we find that Christ is our hope and our help. In times of need, He gives us strength to live our life by overcoming those obstacles. But we expect God to do great things for us. And so sometimes we are disappointed. Sometimes we give up. We fail. And the disciples were just like us. So we can understand that they were in this state of shock. They had some disbelief and some fear. The second thing is their background had conditioned them to disbelief. They felt like everything in their world had changed to a point that the Messiah was coming, but He was not going to ride into the city of Jerusalem on a donkey. He was going to come in on a horse. He was going to overthrow the Roman government and so forth. So they didn't have anything else to do, so they fell back on their Jewish upbringing and education. They began to look at what the Jewish tradition had said. That was something solid that they could reach and go back to. It was not something that was going to go away like Jesus did. So in John chapter 20, verse 9, it says, "For as yet they did not know the Scripture that He must rise again from the dead." Jesus had tried to tell them what was going to take place, but they had a different vision, a different idea, and it was difficult for them to hear what Jesus was saying. You know, sometimes in the church, we're like that. We want the preacher to preach the Bible. We want a church that believes in the Bible. But I've noticed that we want a church and a preacher that embraces the Bible, that reinforces what we've already know and learned and believe. We really don't want the church, we don't want the preacher to challenge us in our beliefs. We don't want Jesus to confront us and root out some of the problems in our life and challenge us that way. We want reaffirmation that what we believe is correct. And I believe that's the reason why we have so many different denominations, because we have searched for a denomination long enough, we'll form one that will reinforce what we believe, whether it's correct or not. Now, Jesus tried to tell them about his resurrection 3 days later, and he used the story of Jonah to help instruct them. You remember the story of Jonah? God said, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh, and I want you to preach the gospel. Well, Jonah didn't like the Ninevites, so he decided that he would do just the opposite. He would board a ship, and he would go to Tarsus. Now, if Nineveh was in that direction, Tarsus was now in this direction. So he's going in the opposite direction that God wanted him to go. And while he was going in the opposite direction, a storm arose, and he subsequently was thrown overboard and swallowed by a great fish, and he was in the belly of that fish for 3 days, and then he was regurgitated on the bank and went to Nineveh, did like he was supposed to. Well, Jesus is saying the belly of that fish, when Jonah was there for 3 days, is symbolic of me going when I will be resurrected from the tomb and will live again. Well, it was difficult for them to understand that. We are post-resurrection people. We have the New Testament. We have the accounts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that helps us to understand the resurrection. We have a lot of time between now and then to digest the resurrection. These first century disciples were on the scene and processing it as it happened. I think about all of the police shootings that we have. And of course, if we have time to replay them in our brain and kind of dissect them and everything, we can make great decisions. But often the police officers out there making the decision in a split second and having to do life and death decisions in a split second is extremely difficult. For them trying to discern the reality of the resurrection in a split second was extremely difficult. It's easier for us. So as a result, they had to fall back on the Jewish education and background that they had. A third thing that was a factor in these disciples' understanding of the resurrection was that they were unconverted. It was the day of Pentecost before they would have one of those got it moments. In the meantime, they were just frail human beings struggling with their spiritual life. But given those circumstances, would you and I have reacted and thought about the resurrection differently? They were struggling spiritually, but on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came in the body of believers and gave them life and power and direction. And they had that moment. You notice Peter, he had kind of a roller coaster kind of faith. He was on the mountain of Transfiguration. It was a high moment in Peter's life, and he was up there on that mountain with Jesus and James and John, and he saw Jesus transfigured before him. He saw Moses transfigured before him. He saw Elijah transfigured before him, and he said, "Oh, Jesus, this is a great moment. We could build 3 tabernacles. We could just stay here forever up on this mountain." But he came off the mountain, and it was just a short while later that he was denying that he ever knew Jesus. And not just once, but 3 times he was denying Jesus. He had had a spiritual lapse, like most of us do at times. And then we find that he was restored, and Jesus says to Peter, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And then, on the day of Pentecost, it was Peter who stood up and said that we need to be baptized and receive the Holy Spirit. And after that, we will have power to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Peter became the leader of the New Testament church, and we never see him wavering again in his faith because now he had the power of the Holy Spirit. It was that gotcha moment. And the disciples had not had that yet. Yeah, they had been with Jesus. They had seen him perform miracles. They had heard him teach parables. They had listened to all of the things that he had to say and do. They didn't understand it. But on the day of Pentecost, they became people that were forever committed to Christ. Now, we have doubts and fears. We are people that look at our background sometimes as a way of informing our present and future. And we have the power of the Holy Spirit. But it makes a difference in how we interpret the resurrection. And these disciples had a great experience that it took them a while to process. And maybe that's the reason why Jesus came back for 40 days. But he wanted them to know and see and experience the proof so that they could be witnesses of the resurrection. And we too are people that need to be witnesses of the resurrection, that Jesus Christ was crucified, buried, and rose again on the third day, and he lives and he rules and he reigns even today. That's the story of the post-resurrection for the church today. I want us to seek the Lord in prayer, and I want to ask him to be with us during this special holy season, but I also want to ask him to keep his hand upon us during these difficult times that we live in. We need God today more than ever. We need his leadership, his guidance, his direction, and he is ever more willing to be with us today than ever before. So let's seek his holy presence in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, we come to you today asking for your grace, your mercy, your guidance, because we are a people that are finding it difficult to believe, to hope, to trust. The world in which we live is very precarious. There's a lot of hatred and bitterness. There's a lot of crime, a lot of things that disturb us and causes us to know that the world needs Christ more today than seemingly ever before. Help us to be instruments and vessels that will lift the name of Christ above all the confusion, doubts, and fears in our world. And help us to point others to Christ Jesus our Lord. Lord, we are people that have had time to process the resurrection. We do not doubt. We know that it's true. We believe the tomb is empty. And now because of that, we ask that you would help us to be able to be proclaimers of that empty tomb, to be witnesses of that empty tomb. We pray for those that are sick. We pray for those that are struggling physically because we believe that you're the great physician who can make well and make whole. We pray for those today that are doubtful and fearful in the world and going through a time when the stresses of life is overpowering them. Give them grace, we pray, even in double portions. Be with us today as we lift the name of Christ. We pray that as we do so, that it will fall upon receptive ears and hearts that need to hear and will embrace the Christ that gives to us newness of life. For we ask it in the blessed name of Christ our Lord and our Savior. Amen. I invite you to join us for worship on this Sunday at 10:30. We will be continuing our series about the resurrection, and I hope that you'll join us for that. Either in person or on YouTube or on Facebook. Any of those are appropriate. We are having more and more people to be vaccinated to come back to worship, and we're grateful for that. But we want you to worship with us in whatever way you feel safe and comfortable doing so. It's not about us. It's not about how you worship. It's about worshiping the one true living God. And I hope that you'll be faithful in doing that. Until we meet again, may God bless you and watch over you and take care of you. We ask in His name. Amen.